of the Ghana delegation to the ECOWAS Parliament. Mr. Speaker, Bureau members, colleagues, I bring to you warm felicitations from the good people of Ghana. Our country report is prepared along the thematic format outlined by the Bureau of the ECOWAS Parliament, and it reflects progress made in the implementation of Ghana's development agenda since the last report to the May 2019 session of the ECOWAS Parliament. The political situation. Mr. Speaker, governments in Ghana have a four-year mandate. The present government, led by His Excellency Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo, is in its third year of the current mandate. As a result, political activities are increasingly gearing up towards elections in December 2020. The four-year tenure of local government, metropolitan, municipal, and district assemblies, as well as unit committees, ended in September this year, and preparations are being made to elect new members of the assemblies on the 17th of December 2019, that is this year. This time, government has made a proposal that chief executives of districts, metropolitan and municipal assemblies should be elected based on political party lines. This will require a referendum for a minimum of 40% voter turnout and a minimum of 75% of yes votes in order to allow government to pass the bill for electing chief executives on party lines. The Electoral Commission has already exhibited voters' registers in preparation for the referendum as well as the assembly elections. The National Identification Authority of Ghana is continuing its mass Ghana card registration across all the 16 regions of the country. The exercise entails the registration and issuance of smart dual interface Ghana cards to 85% of Ghanaians aged 15 years and above. The registration exercise is also covering Ghanaians in the diaspora, and this is being done in collaboration with Ghanaian missions abroad and the Office of the Diaspora Relations of the Presidency. I move to the security situation. Mr. Speaker, the general security situation in Ghana remains stable and under control, and our laws allow for freedom of speech and freedom of association. And in this context, during the reporting period, there were massive demonstrations by political parties and professional groups against government for the erosion in their standard of living and welfare. In September this year, government arrested a group of persons alleging that they were planning a coup d'etat, and these persons have been arraigned before the court and are going through due process of the justice system. Insecurity arising from political vigilantism. The tension caused by the political vigilantism, which we reported in the early part of the year, reduced tremendously following the appointment by government of a commission to investigate the Ayawaso-West Wogon by-election violence in the Greater Accra region. The commission completed its work and published the report, which has been made public. Government published a white paper on the report, accepting most of the recommendations, but rejecting a few. Government also proposed a bill passed by Parliament into law entitled Vigilantism and Related Offenses Act 2019. This law criminalizes the establishment and operation of vigilantes in Ghana. We have also insecurity issues as a result of non-compliant financial institutions. Mr. Speaker, Ghana is a country classified by IMF and World Bank as a middle-income country. And for such an economic transformation, there is often the case that there will be a proliferation of private banks and financial services. As reported in the Ghana's country report to the first ordinary session in May 2019, Ghana went through a turbulent period of insecurity, resulting from several financial institutions not complying with the central bank operating regulations and licensing procedures. As a result, this placed depositors' monies at risk, and government stepped in to close many financial institutions that could not meet the deadline for compliance and had to take steps to the central bank to restructure the entire financial system in Ghana. Higher minimum capital requirements were introduced, and several banks were either closed or merged. This resulted in panic withdrawals that could not be met by the financial institutions and led to liquidation and receivership of the affected banks. There were huge demonstrations in the country by affected depositors, and efforts are now ongoing to refund some part of the monies to the depositors. We also have issues arising from monitoring of terrorism activities, cyber security, and insecurity arising from chieftaincy disputes and other ethnic conflicts. But in all these cases, the security agencies are up to the task and have brought all these issues under control. Mr. Speaker, I would like to focus a bit on the nomadic herders and the crop farmers' conflicts in Ghana. Nomadic herders and crop farmers' conflicts continued during the year. In a town called Bagurugu in the Karaga district of the Northern Region, more than 30 houses of Fulanis were burnt, along with food stocks and personal properties and injuries to persons. In another town called Agogo in the Ashanti region, also conflicts occurred, resulting in loss of more than 1,500 cattle when the Operation Cowleg was launched by the government. Even in the Accra Plains and the Kitta-Ramsar wetlands in the south of the country, effects of nomadic cattle have been felt. They invaded the Ramsar wetlands, destroying the breeding grounds of fish, thus leading to loss of fisheries productivity of the lagoons. On the 8th of October 2019, Ghana hosted a high-level meeting in Accra between the Sahelian countries and the coastal countries in West Africa on the subject of implementing the ECOWAS Transhumance Protocol in order to reduce herder crop farmer conflict and to ensure the integrity of protected zones such as game parks, forest reserves, and Ramsar sites. The meeting, which was the sixth high-level policy dialogue, was to contribute to improving the management of cross-border and international transhumance flows by providing policymakers with information, enabling them to take strategic and operational decisions relating to the movement of animals in West Africa and the Sahel. We also had issues with illegal mining activities, and that is also being controlled by government. I move to the human rights situation. Since the last report to the May 2019 session of the ECOWAS Parliament, no further significant human rights infringements have occurred. Institutions of state tasked with ensuring human rights of citizens continue to discharge their duties responsibly. Youth employment programs. The government continues to implement programs to contain the growing unemployment situation in the country. Several skills training programs have been launched and are ongoing. We have the Nation Builders Course, which is training about 100,000 young men and women to receive skills training across 7 modules, namely Educate Ghana, Heal Ghana, Feed Ghana, Revenue Ghana, Civic Ghana, Digitize Ghana, and Enterprise Ghana. Graduating trainees have been deployed to various places of work, both in the private and the public sector, as stated in the report. The NAPCO Talent Academy, which is a virtual training portal, was developed to provide distance learning and training opportunities to enable trainees acquire the needed exposure to seek permanent employment or venture into entrepreneurship. Within the program implementation period of 36 months, government expects the scheme to deliver a skilled and competent workforce for national development. On the fight against corruption, the Special Independent Prosecutor continues to investigate and bring public officials to the courts. The Auditor General also continues to prepare several annual reports on all ministries, departments, and agencies, and listed surcharges on public officials to refund various sums of monies that have been lost to the state. Ghana's participation in ECOWAS activities, the ECOWAS transport and road infrastructure. Ghana has embarked on a massive rehabilitation and extension of its ports in Tema in order to be the container hub for West Africa. At its peak, it will have 3.7 million tons throughput capacity per month. This is being done under a public-private partnership arrangement between Ghana Ports and Harbors Authority, the Meridian Port Holdings of the Netherlands, and the Bolloré Transport and Logistics APM Company of France, with a shareholding structure of 30%, 35%, 35%, respectively. When completed, Ghana will be the hub for offloading bigger vessels and containers from where other smaller vessels will pick off smaller containers to other ports on the West Coast. It will also be the main hub for moving containers to inland countries such as Burkina Faso and Niger. Ghana's participation in the ECOWAS Trade Liberalization Scheme, called the ETLS. The Task Force on Road Governance under the National Shippers Council and the Ministry of Roads and Highways continue to monitor activities and reporting infringements on the main ECOWAS road corridors. Ghana continues to monitor unauthorized checkpoints within its borders in order to check delays and unauthorized payments in the free movement of transit goods to other neighboring countries through Ghana. Several incidents of corruption still persist on the routes. The ECOWAS biometric card program is also on course and is now linked to the Ghana's national identification card. Mr. Speaker, the joint border post between Ghana and Togo at Akanu and Wepe is yet to fully function after being commissioned twice in 2016 and 2018. I recall Deputy Speaker, Madame Tungara, was the one you delegated to witness the commissioning in Lome. This joint border post is a main flagship project of the ECOWAS under the ETLS and funded by the European Union. However, its non-operation, as at now, we think is a loss to ECOWAS. The main challenge is the non-availability of the software and the fiber optic cables to complete the merger of the customs ICT platform between Ghana and Togo. And we are informed that the supplier of the ICT software and fiber optic cables has refused to pay customs duty on the items at the Port of Lome, hence the inability to clear the items for installation. We want to bring this development to the attention of ECOWAS Commission through Honorable Speaker and to expedite action on this matter in order that the huge investments into the establishment of this joint border post do not go to waste. Mr. Speaker, another issue affecting Ghana's trade with its neighbors in the sub-region is the closure of the Nigerian-Benin border in September this year. Several trucks from Ghana sending goods to Nigeria have been stranded at the Semekraki side of the border for over 2 months now. Similarly, Ghana trucks returning from Nigeria with goods cannot also cross the border. In October this year, a representation from Ghana, made up of our foreign minister and trade minister, met with their Nigerian counterparts to discuss the effects on Ghana of the border closure between Nigeria and Benin. While the Nigerian side claims that the border closure was not targeted at Ghana, but to control some security issues emanating between them and the Republic of Benin, the Ghana side indicated to their Nigerian colleagues that the border closure had collateral damage on Ghana's exports and imports to and from Nigeria since the borders have been closed. We believe that Nigeria may have good reasons for taking such an action, but the measures definitely infringe on the provision of the ECOWAS Trade Liberalization Scheme, called the ETLS. Whatever be the reason, the situation needs to be resolved as quickly as possible. For the medium to long term, Ghana's delegation wishes to propose that the present mandate of the task force on ETLS, headed by the former president of Niger, be expanded to become an office of the trade ombudsman, that is, a clearinghouse. Member countries that wish to undertake measures that will deviate from the provisions of the ETLS must notify this office, and issues such as the objective of the measures, how the measures are to be implemented, and which parts of the country will be affected by the measures, how the impact of the measures will be monitored and reported, the date of commencement of the measures, and the expected date of termination will be considered by this Office of the Trade Ombudsman and member countries notified accordingly. We believe that this may go a long way to create a more open and transparent mechanism for trade conflict resolution in the ECOWAS sub-region. I now move to Ghana's implementation of ECOWAS and other international protocols and treaties. Mr. Speaker, the number of protocols Ghana has ratified has not changed since our last sessional report. Ghana has signed to and ratified 45 of the community protocols, with 9 outstanding. I wish my colleagues would correct that. With 9 outstanding. On the implementation of the ECOWAS Common External Tariff, it is recalled that Ghana began the implementation of this set or the Common External Tariff as early as 2016. It is important to note that the adoption of the Common External Tariff as a uniform regime of customs and related charges to third country goods in member countries of ECOWAS is helping Ghana to address the problem of cross-border smuggling and dumping. On the ECOWAS Single Currency Program, Mr. Speaker, Ghana is committed to the ECOWAS Single Currency Program in the belief that it will help remove trade and monetary barriers, reduce transaction costs, boost economic activity, and eventually contribute to raising the living standards of citizens in ECOWAS member states. Ghana actively participated in all the meetings of the ECOWAS Single Currency Program and contributed its quota towards the process of realizing the single currency program objectives come the year 2020. Economic partnership agreements. Mr. Speaker, the cooperation between the European Union and Ghana has been underpinned by constructive policy dialogue and negotiations based on Ghana's evolving developmental agenda, national priorities, and the principles of aid effectiveness, ownership, and harmonization. Ghana has earlier ratified the Ghana-EU Stepping Stone Economic Partnership Agreement, commonly referred to as the Interim Economic Partnership, in August 2016. This was to enable Ghanaian exporters to continue to enjoy uninterrupted, duty-free and quota-free EU market access. What Ghana has done during the year is to prepare the tariff schedule under the EPA AMS liberalization of Category A products. The implementation of this schedule is expected to commence in the year 2020 after Ghana's cabinet and subsequently parliament has approved the tariff schedule and the liberalization calendar. I want to move to Ghana's hosting of the African Continental Free Trade Area. Mr. Speaker, in July 2019, Ghana won the bid to host the Secretariat of the African Continental Free Trade Area in Accra, Ghana. This followed intense lobbying by our Head of State, Trade Minister, and Minister of Foreign Affairs and Regional Integration. Our delegation, on behalf of the citizens of Ghana, wish to express our gratitude and thanks to the West African countries which supported Ghana's bid. The ECOWAS community levy. Ghana remains in good standing in honoring its payment obligations to the ECOWAS Commission with respect to the 0.5% deductions of import earnings from third countries outside the ECOWAS sub-region. The total levy payment for the third quarter of this year, 2019, to the ECOWAS Commission amounts to 7,107,165.48 US dollars, and the table shows that we are current up to August. So from August, all due payments would also be similarly made to the ECOWAS Commission. I move to the Ghana's performance under the ECOWAS macroeconomic convergence criteria. Mr. Speaker, as at the end of September 2019, Ghana met 3 out of the 4 primary convergence criteria. And the criteria satisfied were 1, average annual inflation of less than 10%, and 2, gross international reserves or import cover of at least 3 months of imports, and C, central bank financing of the budget deficit. Ghana could, however, not meet the criterion of achieving a fiscal budget deficit of below 3% of GDP. With regards to the secondary convergence criteria, Ghana met both criteria on debt to GDP ratio of not more than 70% and the nominal exchange rate variation of not more than plus or minus 10% band. The table shows the details of achievements and the exact, you know, achievements with respect to Ghana. I move to Ghana's macroeconomic performance. Mr. Speaker, provisional estimates from Ghana Statistical Services indicates that our non-oil real GDP growth rate was 5.2% in the first 2 quarters of January to June 2019, while the overall GDP growth, including oil, was 6.2% at the end of June. These figures are one of the highest in the sub-region. We have also reported on the agricultural sector growth because agriculture continues to employ about 40% of the adult population in Ghana. We have reported on interest rates, the monetary sector performance, and the Ghana Stock Exchange performance. In summary, these economic indicators point to a growing economy, and our prospects for the year 2020 look very good. I will move to environment and climate change. The general weather conditions between January and October 2019, Ghana experienced unusual weather conditions with heavy rainfall this year, particularly in October, November, resulting in flooding of the northern parts of the country, killing about 28 persons and with thousands internally displaced. Our National Disaster Management Organization, together with NGOs and some political parties, responded swiftly with relief items to bring the situation under control. Under climate change, Ghana implemented several programs and projects within the period. We launched the Cocoa Reds program in October 2019. The Cocoa Reds program plus is aimed at promoting a climate smart cocoa regime in Ghana, and the intervention program was led by the Ghana Cocoa Board, Forestry Commission, World Cocoa Foundation, and civil society organizations in the cocoa industry, as well as other players. Climate smart cocoa farming is the production of cocoa without forest degradation, but rather with methods that enrich the vegetation cover and nature. Through the program, cocoa farmers are being supplied. We have listed some of the main topics that were addressed during the summit. I move to the launch of the Climate Adaptation Policy and Strategy for Ghana. Mr. Speaker, in May 2019, the Ministry of Environment, Science and Technology and Innovations launched the National Climate Change Adaptation Strategy for Ghana. The overall goal of this strategy is to enhance Ghana's current and future development by strengthening its adaptive capacity and building resilience of the society and ecosystems to the impact of climate change. I move to the amendment of the Kyoto Protocol.